Hello, fellow extremophiles. I'm Pruitt. This is Jim Davis. And remember, neither snow nor rain nor heat nor gloom of night should keep you adventurers from the swift completion of your appointed quest, unless you die in the first round from exposure. It's Extreme Environments on WebDM.
Extreme Environments.
Yeah.
Got a request from some Patreon peoples.
Yeah.
And I think this is a good one, because it's one of those that's kind of like, sometimes in D&D you can kind of get in a rut where you're just,
yes,
you're on a road, and things happen,
yeah,
and maybe there's some bushes and stuff, so there's some cover, but it's mostly like flat, and yeah, you know, you do your fighting, and you push people around, and then you win, and that's it.
It's easy for, you know, fall in that kind of habit of thinking that way. The battle mat's flat, the table you're playing on is flat, if you're even using those things at all.
Maybe you still use Euclidean geometry.
Sure. You know, just a sameness to it, a kind of like one note, you know, for people looking to transform their combats, to transform their encounters that they have and the locations that their players visit, then it's worth really thinking about, like, hey, what are all the variety of places that this scene could take place, or that, mm-hmm, this ambush could take place, and then like identifying the ones that work for your campaign, you know, bigging them up in terms of like their magical you know, like, mm-hmm, footprint, and then like making a D&D location out of them. And I think for me, it's the extreme environments that you can find here on Earth or in our own, you know, planets in our own solar system that really inspire me. And it's less about like what kind of weird fantastical flying castle kind of place can I think of, and more like, what do you mean the ocean freezes and the tide goes out and there's like a whole underwater realm with the ice above you and you're on the ocean floor, and like, how is that not a dungeon?
Where do you consider the edges of extreme?
So extreme would be anything that's like super inconvenient to have to live in. Anything where, certainly like from a human or gameable perspective, like you can't just go there and live. There's a lack of oxygen, there's a lack of maybe water, there's, yeah, extreme heat or cold, you know, acidic or alkaline environments. All of those seem to me to be like extreme environments.
Yeah, so it kind of sounds like any environment that you need to be in where you're going to need at least some kind of extra gear or,
yeah,
spell.
Yeah, something.
Just to move around.
And what I love about these places in our own world is that so many of them are filled with life. You know, that I think of things like the ocean floor is one,
oh,
of those,
yeah,
where you're like, yeah, I didn't think there was much down there. What's this thing? You know, it's like a whole coral reef miles under the earth next to vents in the ocean floor. There's crabs and lobsters and fish and everything else down there. And it's similar for a lot of places where you think there's not much, or you think like, yeah, what is it that's there? And looking and seeing in our own world gives me, at least, and hopefully gives you, inspiration to sort of create new and interesting locations in D&D. I happen to be on a big ocean kick because I'm running an underwater aquatic campaign, so that's where my head's at, but it applies to other sort of environments.
Yeah, I mean, there's mountains under the ocean.
Absolutely, there are mountains under the ocean. Any place that the players, and now we're talking purely in game terms, not just like, you know, our own world, but like where the characters can't just go there. Like, so a forest or a jungle might be an extreme place, but it's not like an extreme environment in the sense that, you know, it might be gross, hot, lots of things trying to eat you, but it's still hospitable. You don't need anything extra, mm-hmm, to live there, unless you're dealing with like a giant fungal jungle and it's full of, you know, spores and, mm-hmm, flesh-eating fungi and things like that. That's more of an extreme mm-hmm, example. You can't just go there. You need equipment, spells, you know, support.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I would see maybe like if you have like some kind of D&D-esque jungle, like a deep rainforest that's like almost like bordering on like the outlands or something.
Sure,
you know?
Sure, yeah.
And so it's one of those things where like that you can't even touch the ground because all the trees,
mm-hmm,
are,
mm-hmm,
almost growing out of the ground,
right,
as the same organism. So you're literally having to climb over
things,
everything, and
yeah,
your visibility's like 20 feet because of all the, yeah, foliage.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Not only that, there's just life everywhere.
It's highly specialized, mm-hmm,
and it's all looking right at you.
You're the outsider here. Uh-huh. You know, you don't have any specialized defenses against any other stuff. You touched on two things that sort of also characterize extreme environments for me, and that's visibility and movement. And
yeah.
Very often in these places, like movement, the very act of getting from point A to point B is difficult. Think of like the Arctic or the Antarctic, and just like how difficult it is to walk in that kind of cold, to,
yeah,
be bundled up and to have everything that you need, the cold's going to sap your strength. It's going to get inside your nose, your mouth, anywhere you breathe. You're going to feel it as like a sharp sort of stab almost. It's
anything exposed is going to burn.
It's going to burn until you don't feel it at all.
And that's later.
Yeah, I think you're like a snow blind and you know, the wind kicking up snow drifts and making the cold worse. If you get wet, it's going to be bad. So just being out there is bad and should be a challenge. And so I think these make perfect places for set piece battles, for villain lairs, for places of confrontation, or just like one-off adventures where, you know, you're trying to get to some place that no one's ever been before, no one's been to in a long time. And in that sense, like I just find a lot of inspiration out of these locations.
Let's kind of just run down a few of these settings and ways to kind of envision them, the challenges that each pose. Since we already started in the Arctic,
yeah.
I mean, we're already talking about how difficult it is. I mean, like, imagining it's however below zero and then you get attacked, and what if you don't have your gauntlets on and you got to draw your sword?
Yeah.
It could be a bad day.
You could take some skin off with it, I think.
Yeah. Casting heat metal just to let go of your sword.
This is one of those where, especially if we're talking about like D&D 5th edition, where the environmental hazards section in the DMG is like super small, there's not a lot of ground covered, and mostly it relates to, you know, make a con save to avoid exhaustion, or this costs like double move or something like that. So like, the mechanical groundworks for those things are there, but need to be expanded on. When it comes to like cold, I think of things like, you know, this is sapping your energy. You know, and I'm someone who most of my life I lived in a place without any snow, and now live in a place with like where it gets flipping cold and there's snow and it's inconvenient. It's difficult to walk around. You never know when you're going to step in a patch and hit like ice and fall down. You don't know. You know, it's hard to conceptualize how difficult it is to walk through deep snow. It's light, it's fluffy, but it's just it takes extra time. Mm-hmm. Similar to like walking on like loose sand, your legs get kind of sore afterwards. They don't usually have to do this much work.
Yeah, friction and traction do what they're supposed to. And just move on instead of covering the same ground as you keep sliding through it. I mean,
yeah. So it's like, do you not have the proper equipment? Are you not prepared for it? If you're caught out in the open, it could be bad news. Now, something where as much as like a swift breeze is enough to get inside your cloak and completely chill you to the bone. And you might not stop shivering at all. And then now your teeth are rattling. You can't quite get a hold of your own bodily movement. If you had to fight, your adrenaline might, you know, kick in, and you wouldn't have to worry too much about that. But afterwards, you might be completely exhausted, and now you are sweating, tired
in
your clothes, and that's bad. Trust me. Once you start sweating and it's freezing outside, that's bad. You know, your body can't regulate its temperature because you're not allowed, you know, there's, you can't like expose your skin, you know, it's going to get frozen, but now you're too warm. So it's just bad news all around.
You're gonna get sick.
Depending on what kind of campaign you want, you might drill in on those and like really get into the nitty gritty of it. Maybe those kind of cold conditions are only created through supernatural means. They're created through spells and magical beings like Yeti and White Dragon and Snow Hags and things like that.
Oh, yeah. They gather too many together. And
yeah.
It just makes the weather worse.
It just makes the weather worse and worse and worse. And now there's winter wolves, and now it's really bad. That may be where I start with terms like just making it more D&D, but definitely find mechanical options beyond the tools that you have, like exhaustion, half movement. You know, it might be that they take cold damage, but it's never lethal at this stage. Or you start taking away their hit dice and saying like, yeah, this is a bit different than exhaustion. This is, you'll feel this later is when you're going to feel this, right?
Yeah, that's actually a pretty good idea. Instead of taking a level of exhaustion, all right, take a hit die off.
Yeah, you know, yeah. This
creature hits you, take some damage, and take a hit die.
Yeah, yeah. And if you are looking to have something like that where it's like this is going to build up against them, and sort of give them a sense of dread and of something being depleted without shooting them into the death spiral that is exhaustion levels, then, yeah, taking away hit dice can be a one way to do that. I think these are fun, you know. I mentioning earlier, like, the that sort of frozen sea where the tide has gone out. And underneath, there's still all the ocean life. There's still coral or whatever aquatic vegetation that there is. There's the, you know, crab and fish swimming around little puddles. Maybe that's where the dragon lairs, is in between this world of frozen sea and the ice above. It's inhospitable. It can't get to it most of the time, especially if it's like permanently frozen, you know. Or maybe it's like connected to icebergs and that like tunneled out icebergs and you're sort of in this like mini glacial palace or some kind. Like those are the sorts of things that I think of when I think of like adventuring in a cold climate. Mm-hmm. The frost giants and ice caves and yeti and all manner of just creatures that, do they cause the snow or are they just brought here because of the snow? Like that's the question I like having to grapple with. I love a good underwater adventure and I it's been reinforced to me several times that one of the ways to challenge D&D characters who are of a higher level is to plunge them underwater and watch as they try to deal with the environment. We recommended it on here several times, but I've been wanting a long time to run like a pure, everybody's Triton and Merfolk and Lokatha and things like that. And I found that the rules in 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons to support underwater adventuring are, like a lot of the rules in the DMG, not particularly elaborate or reflective of kind of a more, an approach that has a higher degree of fidelity to sort of concerns that you have in the real world. Mm-hmm. And I just was like, it's way too easy to overcome the limitations on fighting that are down there. And to sort of summarize off the top of my head, it basically, unless you're using a dagger, trident, spear, like piercing weapon, you're going to suffer disadvantage on that, on your attack. And then ranged attacks beyond the minimum range, or that first range increment, automatically miss. And then if they are in that first range increment, they have disadvantage. All of that's negated, or at least the melee weapon restrictions are negated if you have swim speed. I just find it very, like, simplistic. It's a lot of things in 5th edition are easily negated so that you don't really have to worry about it. And while I appreciate sort of the idea of not getting bogged down in a bunch of rules minutiae, I kind of feel like I'm underwater. I want the rules to be more reflective of the different nature of this environment. Like, let's go ahead. I found Aluria Publishing's The Cerulean Seas for Pathfinder, and that book has a ton of cool ideas for adventuring under the water and on the waves, including how to calculate buoyancy, drag, pressure, all kinds of things that I see as being unique enough to the underwater environment that I would want to include them. I want players kind of thinking about, am I buoyant enough for this? Mm-hmm. Like, I might need to sink.
Without expending energy to swim down.
Yes, but you don't want to expend the energy to swim down. Or at the same time, it might be, maybe they don't want to sink. Maybe you have a depth tolerance. You know, you can't go below 600 feet before you start suffering serious repercussions. Then I want to know, how do you sink naturally? I didn't quite go to the extreme that the Cerulean Seas does in terms of calculating, and I mostly just like, hey, we're going to call encumbrance buoyancy, but we will be using it. And the others, things like drag or the effect of currents or some things like that, I use on an ad hoc basis. But to me, they're present. They affect things. And the difference between, say, running a combat on land and running a combat underwater is both the 3D environment, the fact that there's going to be currents that move you along, mm-hmm. and that they might have, it might be possible to enter and exit that current at different places in the 3D map. Like, it creates an environment where it's sufficiently different. You know, players are having to think like, well, I got to swim above this person to drop my net on them because I can't throw it at them. It's going to go 5 feet before it does nothing, mm-hmm. but I can weight it and drop it on them. You know, I can attach a set of weights. I can fill like air bladders to the net and get underneath them and have it lift up around them. Yeah. And so they start thinking of things like that. You present enemies that utilize that environment. That's kind of like not necessarily an extreme environment. It's just like you can't breathe. And as long as you're, near the surface, you're probably going to be fine. But I like thinking about sort of what's on the ocean floor, what's there. And it's, as a subject, it's just like interests me as a person. Like, I'm kind of obsessed with what's on the ocean floor, just me. I kind of go to the beach and I'm like, I could just walk there if there wasn't water. Like, I want to see it. In my mind, the ocean floor is as D&D of a place as anywhere else. The abyssal plains are home to vast hordes of, like, starfish people or sea cucumber people that just wander around as ravening barbarians and contending with the vast amounts of undead that have to be down there, right? Like, all the...
Every shipwreck,
every dead whale that just, like, sank to the bottom and reanimated halfway through being devoured. And then you got, like, the abyssal trenches where it's like, yeah, that's where the Aboleth City is. Like, that thing's, like, 7 miles down into the crust of this planet. That's where they are, you know? That's where the Kraken is and all the other. It's an alien world. And I also like it because you don't have to do anything to make monsters out of fish. Particularly not those that are found in the deep sea. No. Because they're already monstrous looking. They glow and twist themselves into impossible shapes. They can swallow things larger than themselves.
Yeah, they're just mouths and eyes with a dangling, glowing light.
Yes.
Like, having your own fucking bait, like lit bait, as part of your body.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's some D&D shit.
An anglerfish the size of a car. Or some primordial lizard fish that lives down there. It's just a whole world out there. And yet, when you go too far down, you can't see. There's crushing water pressure. It's cold.
It's cold, yeah.
All of these things. If you're going down to the ocean floor, there might be cold seeps where the hypersalinity of the water is so great that it sends you to toxic shock. There might be, vents or something where the water around them is so hot it could melt lead, and yet there's coral and crabs and lobster and all kinds of things. And it's
those
just
damn extremophiles.
Those damn extremophiles, that damn bacteria that lets them live down there. And it's like, that's a D&D world. Like, where is the mer sorcerer who has captured the pearl that, when thrown into the dawn sea foam, will create the world anew? It's down there at the bottom. You got to find a way to get down there, bring a Triton, because they're immune to that shit, and go adventure down there. It's an extreme place because I can have an environment that's like a vertical coral wall on a seamount that's growing, volcanic eruption up near the surface, and it's just constantly pouring down. Small steaming bits of rock deep into the ocean, and like around that are a bunch of, say, aquatic but also fire attuned creatures, and I can start juxtaposing things. What is a fire elemental that live in water doing? You know, how does that work?
But so it's boiling all the time.
Yeah, right. Well, yeah. It could be like more. Yes, it might be more like a steam elemental,
yeah,
or a boiling elemental or something, or magmen, or you know, there's just so much you can do with underwater. And it's really one of those places in D&D that could use a lot more love. And I'll carry that flag. I don't mind.
Damn right. Captain of the water polo team. Let's flip the script and dry off a bit. Traveling in the desert.
Yeah.
I mean, should it be so extreme that you force your players to have, like, PCs to drink their own pee? I mean, are we Bear Grylls in it here? I mean, it's like,
how? I let them, you know, like, if they didn't have any water otherwise, I might be like, yeah, sure. I mean, now all of these extreme environments, if you've got a ranger in the party, if you've got someone who can sort of negate these things, you're playing 5th edition D&D or something like it, then, you know, you want to think how the interaction with them goes. Absent that, to me, the big thing with, like, deserts is the lack of water. I mean, that's what defines it, right? It's the lack of water. It could be cold, it could be hot, but there's just no water here. And in that sense, it's low vegetation. The animals that are there, have to go through extreme lengths to get what they need. And, like, adventures there should, if we're kind of, like, thinking pie in the sky, like, should feature that somehow. Like, the contending against that slow draining, there's the unbearable heat, the relentless energy sapping, scorching, blistering heat.
Yeah, cooked all day and frozen all night.
It cooked all day, yeah. And so, like, in Land Between Two Rivers, when it's really hot, basically the summer, everyone has these same vulnerabilities and limitations with regards to the sun that vampires have. That's just the end of it. There are two giant-ass blazing suns in the sky. There's nothing to shade you. You've got sunlight sensitivity, and if you stay out too long, you're going to start taking damage. And, yeah. and that's just the case. And most people don't...
Like even those with fire resistance? Or those are the ones that are okay?
If you have fire resistance, you're fine. You wouldn't have to worry about that. They can keep going out. And normally, if they're native or to the desert, they're acclimatized to the extreme heat. So I wouldn't make them make exhaustion checks or anything. Mm-hmm. Normally, unless they were wearing like heavy armor or a lot of clothes. But
well, I mean, that's just not...
Right. They're acclimatized to this. But then when it gets to be summer and it gets to be like, oh yeah, we're getting close to the two suns that we orbit, that's when it gets to be like, yeah, people don't go out in the day. They just don't. Mm-hmm. And here's why. You'll take a lot of damage around. It's going to scorch you, burn the flesh right off of you. That's like a magical sort of desert, and it's filled with like pockets of magical radiation and other sorts of places. Mm-hmm. In terms of just like a normal desert and how to get through it, I think the base checks that are in 5th edition are good. Con check for exhaustion, staying out of the heat might help with that, or being soaked, or have some water would help. But to me, it's like, well, if you didn't drink water, then it's just going to get worse. What I want to see for some of these are just more conditions, mm-hmm. like of the mechanical sort. Because when I start thinking about them, I think like, well, it's either exhaustion, taking away hit die, or something else. And so I feel like there could be more options available for like representing the fact that these environments are harsh. Mm-hmm. Maybe you just like bump the difficulty of everything that the players do when they're in one of these environments, especially like a desert, right? The heat, the mania that comes on from just being subjected to that.
Oh yeah,
I just make things difficult.
Oh yeah, and then you. Well, what I love is you can then start really. If a big bad is in the middle of a desert, maybe it's a blue dragon or something like that.
Yeah,
and now they're an illusionist, so now you're fucking with the party.
Oh god,
if they're actually dumb enough to walk around during the day, mirages left and right of oasis and waterfalls and whatever. Mm-hmm, But the thing is you should be walking around at night, right? You should be moving at night, but that's when all the predators come out.
Right, yeah.
Few that there are. Mm-hmm. But now you're dealing with a whole other thing. Now you're dealing with visibility. Mm-hmm. And it's cold.
Yeah.
And you've been sweating all day.
Yeah, you're going to get really cold.
And now you're freezing your ass off. Yeah. It's an interesting place in that, with just the absence of the sun, how you can just flip the script.
And there are those deserts that they freeze over at night. High elevation deserts. And they're cold as shit. Like, they're really cold. Things will freeze. What water there is will freeze there. But then the day, it's hot enough. And
Would you introduce an exhaustion mechanic for your resources? Like, roll for your water. Like, does some of your water start to evaporate because it's so hot?
I would, yeah.
Right?
In a lot of these, I think a lot of the extreme environments, I would implement some kind of, like, when do the depletable resources in my gear deplete? Yeah. And
when does it perish?
And when do the durable goods that are there begin to break down? Because part of this is, like, your ice pick never breaks when you're trying to traverse an ice canyon. Then that's a source, then you're cutting yourself off from a source of tension. If you never run out of oxygen when you're, 200 feet below the water, the surface of the water, and you have to find an air pocket or something, maybe there's like a kelp frond or something, you can pop one of those air sacs and get something. Those are the kinds of things, like depleting the mundane resources, like did your armor break because a buckle snapped from the cold, or is there like too much sand in your mail and it's starting to like make it less effective? It's starting to stick or something like that. Those are the kinds of things you can think of. I like having something where it's like, did the player roll a one? And I just sort of like keep in mind that anytime a one is rolled, then maybe I would check, roll a saving throw, a simple saving throw for the item. One of the straps on your backpack broke, If you try to fight with something like that on, it's going to be even worse than it normally is. Or your blade has a notch in it that has only gotten bigger and bigger. And, the last time you fought with this sword, you've now noticed there's a big just split in it. You don't look like it's going to survive much longer. You still have one, but it's on its way to breaking. Mm-hmm. And so coming up with things like that, conditions for gear, is it in good condition, poor condition, in need of repair? I like those because you're attacking a part of the character sheet that the players don't normally have attacked. They might want some of that gear or need it and they don't have it.
It makes sense though.
Yeah.
I mean, these items, like, unless you explicitly go and buy like master crafted gear.
Sure, yeah.
Which even some of that, I mean, if it's leather in the cold, extreme cold, it's eventually going to harden and crack.
Yeah.
you know, unless it's been treated with oils, but you can also introduce a whole new slew of, like, not necessarily magic items, but just like enhancement items for just gear. These oil. Yes. Oh, you're going to travel into the desert. Make sure you get this oil and put it on your gear so it doesn't dry and crack. Yep. You know, things like that. Special whetstones for short swords and and the like.
Yeah, we do it for, so you know, in the underwater game, we're playing Aquatic Adventures. It's like there are options for non-water breathers and. One of my rules for that campaign is there are no potions. No one uses potions. They use other things. Powders, tinctures, whatever it is. They just don't quaff a potion. So in this case, in order to breathe underwater, people swallow a lung eel. And it's an eel that goes into your lung and attaches itself, and it sort of does its breathing for you. But if you keep it in there longer, a week, it's going to lay eggs, and they'll come out eventually. So you have
to... sneeze eggs.
Yeah. Ship's alchemist, who will hand out these lung eels... also hands out like poison that you have to swallow to, or sorry, snort to get it in your lungs to get the eel out. But then you also, you know, you're snorting poison, and there's a drawback there.
Yeah, you gotta ride the lightning, man.
Yeah, and the DCs for those are relatively low, and you know, like most of that's handled off screen. But I wanted something that like reinforces this place is weird, different. But there's also things there if you needed more. You know, lung eels, you just go catch them or breed them. And so you do something similar with like the desert. Maybe there's an oasis where the water there like provides you an even better bonus, a bigger boost for surviving there. Or if it's, you know, like the cold, it's something that either helps you resist the cold, see better during a snow glare, walk on the top of the snow as if it were dry ground, just like something to give you an edge. And now you're starting to seed your map with like bonuses and things that players can go and get. And now you've given them a reason to walk around and explore and blah.
Like anyway. A special cold. I'm just imagining like in cold environments, a special coal that you burn to heat your water and fluids. And when you drink that, it keeps you warm for, you know, just determine a time. Like anything heated by this thing will keep you extra warm. For, basically give you, you know, environmental protection for, you know, an hour or 6 hours.
Yeah. Giving the players tools to help them survive, help them overcome, because also, like, you're giving them a rope to hang themselves with. You're giving, you know, you're letting them get in over their head, and sort of like why you might give a powerful magic item before it's, you know, sort of appropriate to give them is because you want them to get in trouble with it. Yeah. And you also want them to have a powerful tool to get themselves out of trouble, but you want them to get in trouble with it. And so I feel the same with like with some of these environments.
Okay, well let's elevate this conversation a bit and talk about like, you know, kind of mountainous or volcanoes, that where you're having to climb. This is where all of the ubiquitous cliffs in D&D.
It's
either flat plain or on the side of a mountain.
I think for me, I fail to appreciate how large mountains are. And it's easy to sort of think of them as just big hills and you can just sort of walk up them. But having sort of lived amongst some mountains for a while and have friends that are closer to them, and you just sort of see like, this is not just a big hill. There's something different about this edifice. You gotta like plan your route. You've got to know where exactly you want to go. It's not just I find the abstraction of the skill system in most D&D just doesn't do this task justice.
Yeah, it's a different kind of loss when you're climbing a mountain.
Yeah,
and you get lost. You think you're going right until you work your way up, and you're now you can't ascend.
And
going back is going to be
tough.
Twice as hard.
Right, yeah.
And how much time did you waste?
Like, there's a lot of these things that just, they get hand-waved because they can be a hassle to run. Players, if you know, if they don't have a buy-in for the environment working against them, they might just sort of feel like, well, why can't I just make a climb check and move on with it? You know, why can't I just make a swim check and move on with it? I want something more out of it, and I think that there are enough people who would that it's worth pursuing. Like, how many ropes are you going to need to climb that thing? How many other people do you need to help you? You know, what is it that's at the top that you need to get? Those are the other questions that I might ask. Like, why are you climbing the mountain in the first place? Is it to find someone, get something, a quest? That sort of.
Yeah, well, Jim, you climb a mountain because it's there.
Because it's there, I know.
I mean, just look at... Well, when thinking about it, like, look at Everest. Like, right? Yeah. Like, consequently... I hope they do limit the climbing of Everest because
there needs to be garbage up there.
Well, not only garbage, but just the amount of people, like the bodies that they're finding and the people that are dying just to just to do a thing to say they did a thing, right? Like all it really is in the real world now is just like, I have enough money to put together an expedition and pay someone to walk me up this mountain so I can take a selfie.
Oh, sure, it's gorgeous. Those panorama views of Mount Everest, yeah. This is literally, like, this is, I just like looking out a plane window.
Yeah, I was watching a report that was like this company that will, like, Photoshop you into that shit. And it's just like, really? Like, really?
You don't want to do any of that shit in your game.
No.
You want to have a satisfying experience where you climb the dwarves' holy mountain to go find the hammer of the gods so that they can forge the end times blade or whatever it is they need to do to win Ragnarok.
Yeah.
You know, like, that's the kind of things that you might go up there. I really love, like, the Clark Ashton Smith Hyperborea story where, you know, the prince of some city-state has to, you know, it's like, we're going to go hunt these degenerate man-beasts that live in caves at the top of this mountain. And, like, they climb and climb and climb, and all along the way his retainers and followers just can't keep up, and it's just this warrior king. Then he runs across a wizard and gets a compulsion cast on him and has to descend into the bowels of the mountain. But it's that first climb where they're just describing, like, the howling wind that's trying to scrape you off the face of this cliff and trying to get your fingers to find purchase on you know, cold, hard rock. And there's nothing up here. It's barren. The oxygen is thin. It's possibly frozen. You know, and so it's just it's as inhospitable as I can think of. And yet there's people there. Tibetan herders who move their herds between mountain passes, and like trying to get them down some of the mountain slopes is like, what can we do? Well, we can just hope they don't cause an avalanche or tumble down the mountain and crush us. Just like the thought and care that goes into that. I can see, like, you would do similar to the mountain peoples that live in your campaign worlds. Like, how do they deal with these harsh environments? What kind of weird architectural, not weird, but what kind of, like, necessary architectural advances have they had to make to live up here? How do they make roads and bridges and all that stuff?
Or lifts.
Or I mean, lifts,
like,
yeah.
Like, thinking about just Game of Thrones with the Wall or the Eerie.
Sure.
And you can kind of think about those in different places, but, like, you know, when you think about the climb, where you're just literally climbing a fucking wall all day,
right,
and half the people die just because the sun came out.
The sun came out.
And avalanches start happening.
Yeah,
you know,
oh, God.
And things start giving away.
Yeah, especially if you, like, start combining things. So, like, mountain and cold often go together, and now you're having to deal with, like, all right, I got to climb this cliff face, but it's a frozen waterfall. Right? And that's inherently incredibly unstable as opposed to, you know, whatever, but that's the only time of the year you can climb it. This is the only place that you can get to is in the winter when this thing freezes over. All the other, you know, well, Jim, why don't they just fly up there? Well, because that's not the point. You know, not everyone can fly, and maybe the wind's too strong. Maybe it's just too much.
Your 60-foot flight speed when the wind is 100 miles an hour. Like, go ahead and fly.
Go ahead, do it.
Later.
Yeah.
You know.
Keeping with sort of the Earth theme, volcanoes and other tectonic, you know, sites of tectonic activity can be really, really fun. A volcanic eruption, particularly one that's more like slower and less violent, is just sort of like a constant oozing fields of magma and flowing rivers of molten rock.
It's harder to breathe. Because of the toxic fumes, and that can really start to sap your strength. Also, I had Starward Bound, and we had a whole fight near a volcano that was actually a portal in the plane of fire. But you know, I would just roll every now and again because there were just arcs of molten lava that just come out, and it's like, well, I'll roll this, and if I get near, you know, whatever number, that number represents the player.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, you know, if I decided they were number 15 and I rolled a D20 and I rolled a 17, well,
yeah,
guess what?
Close.
That thing landed next to you, and now there's a burning hunk of, you know, nobody ever used it, but it was more of just like, let's see if they, like, try to kick people into that.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like a flaming sphere that's just sitting there.
You need to roll it down, roll it back down the hill. I like that kind of thing because it's sort of, especially when you have environments that give the player something to interact with. It's one thing to have a fancy backdrop, but having, like, a volcanic rocks that they can kick around or use with magic to as a missile, or, like, you know, something that I try to do is, like, there's flora and fauna in the ocean that you can just harvest for weapons and armor, and you know, the people that live down here, they don't really make that kind of thing. They just grow coral. And so
the coral spear.
Right, there's a sense of, like, once you start, the next step in any of these things, once you've described the environment, is to start thinking of things that you can give your players that they can interact with, that they can take with them, that they can use to accomplish their goals. And that's why we spend a lot of time thinking about the environment, because that's what it's there for, to interact with. play yeah. with. Have a good time.
Let's keep going yeah. up oh and away.
God, we're gonna go back up.
And kind of move into like upper atmosphere or yeah. like what I just see this is just like you're in open air.
Yeah.
Whether this is just above a mountain, above a landmass, yeah. whether you're in the plane of air.
Uh-huh.
Like I would say, even though it's not D&D, but it's my game right now, Breath of the Fall, it's in a vertical shaft
sure.
that is just open air, except near a wall. And so it presents a whole other challenge, because this yeah. is where it's like, you know, you need to be really good at either climbing for that.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it's like, well, do you have any way to fly?
Do you have any way to fly? Do you have any way to walk on clouds? Do you have any way to do whatever? There's stuff up there. There's cloud giants, gold dragons. Mm-hmm. Depending on what kind of cosmology you have, there might not be a separation between the vacuum of space and the planet. You know, you might, you know, I just keep going.
Yeah.
You know, you could literally be on your way to heaven if you know, in some campaign worlds. You know, the upper atmosphere and sort of like the beginnings of outer space are those parts of the game where I think it's fun to interject real magic and fantasy. Like the upper atmosphere, that's where the air spirits live. Like that's where the wind lives. Like not just conceptually, but like Joe, the wind guy, that's where they live. You know, that's how I conceive of it. You know, that's where the spirits of these things, maybe that's where they hang out. That's their lounge, because it's like, yeah, nobody can find us up here.
Look at us every day looking up, never know.
Right. Or maybe it's like a whole other world above the clouds, and the clouds are some kind of weird illusion that people on the ground think are one thing, but when you get up there, you realize, like, no, there's a whole other place up here. Mm-hmm.
You have to find the right vine to climb
up. You just have to find the right vine, the right staircase, the right moonbeam, yeah. You know, the right rainbow, whatever it is to get up to the cloud kingdoms. But, you know, like, why not? That seems really fun. And if you're running a more like whimsical game of D&D or you need like a whimsical break, it can be a really fun sort of like, oh, there's a fairy giant's castle up here. The upper atmosphere, you know, combines again with like mountain. But to me, it gets really cool when you start thinking about what's in space. How do you traverse and navigate all of that?
Well, indeed. I mean, you know, as everybody on the long-time viewers of the show, they know that that's my jam. I love thinking about D&D in space.
Yes.
And the fact that, you know, that there at least has been rule, there have been rules in the past that were just like, yeah, you know, you got an air pocket, you know, you want to keep it fresh.
Yeah. Yeah.
Don't let that run out. Okay. But there are ways around it. Just get near something else. They instilled these rules, but they kept it kind of like usable enough where it's not like, yeah, if you're going to go up there, you're probably just going to die in a week.
And this is a lot like how you would talk about with, say, lava. Is this cartoon lava or like real lava? Does it boil you before you can get anywhere close to it and kill you with toxic fumes and roast you and peel the skin off of you? Or can you like walk across it really fast? You know? Yeah.
Williams that shit.
Right. It's sort of the same way with outer space. Is it outer space with the vacuum and the radiation and the micro dust and all that stuff that you got to watch out for? Or is it just like space as we thought of it in the 20s or, you know, before we really knew what was going on? It's like the ether, you know, or in, you know, there's air up there. Of course there is. There's air everywhere.
Yeah.
And, you know, like you could treat it like that. I think that could be pretty fun, especially if you want it really accessible. There's people living on the moon. They're just moon people, you know. or maybe moon. Maybe they're all lycanthropes. They're just
lycanthropes. It's a full moon every day.
It's a full moon every day. You know, what's it like up there? What's up there? I mean, I think the vastness and emptiness is stuff to focus on. So maybe there's not a lot up there, but maybe it's who's up there. And again, I kind of think undead. There's like cathedral tombs, tomb ships. Of just like lich lords and powerful undead sorcerers and the like, and all of their skeletons and whites and ghosts and things. So I kind of tend to think that the most extreme places they're mostly undead that's there.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
All those stars that collapse into like black holes, which are just portals to the negative energy plane.
Yeah. And they start becoming corpse stars and home to all manner of horrors and things like that. Yeah. So, I mean, taking your D&D campaign into space is a bold step, maybe.
at least one small step.
Yeah, but you could do it in a way that doesn't necessarily mean you've got to start a Spelljammer campaign by having something like a teleport portal to the moon or an asteroid or something. Or maybe there's like an orbital castle that a powerful archmage or something just created for themselves and you find a way in. Or a druid grows a tree tall enough to reach out there, because it's like, this tree needs sunlight that's unfiltered by the atmosphere.
Grow it up there.
It's a world tree.
Maybe he's growing a tree because he wants a new moon in the
sky. Maybe he wants a new moon.
And he's got to get grow it up there so he can climb to the top and hang the new moon.
There's other kind of extreme environments, you know, any forest or jungle that, like, is poisonous or like the life there is so vigorously alive that you know, that's inhospitable. But like most forests and jungles are actually kind of like, they get a lot of stuff you could use, and they're mm-hmm. really, you know, depending on your tolerance for humidity and rain, probably very imminently habitable.
Yeah, well, I think another way you can make pretty much any mundane environment an extreme environment is really ramp up the weather.
Yes,
like,
yeah.
Ramp that shit up. You got a coastal city that hurricanes come in every week.
Yeah.
The tides are raining hundreds of feet.
Yeah.
When the tides come in and out.
Yep.
I mean, like, there are ways to just go crazy with
extreme.
It.
Yeah. Ocean waves that when you sail up them, you're sailing vertically. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, like, and with creatures that hunt the, you know, the waves, you know, between them. Those are the kinds of things that I build try to build memorable encounters out of. And so, like, I might be trying to build a memorable location, and it's going to have less gameable elements in it. But things that I want to be a memorable, place to set an encounter or to have mm-hmm. a lair or something like that. I'm going to spend a lot of time thinking, like, how can this be exploited from a game perspective? What choices are the players making? What does this environment force in terms of choice? So an example would be like, do we press on or do we turn back? Do we, walk in the desert? Are we out at night and risk running into more terrible predators, but then we don't have to deal with the heat? You know, you're offering choices in that sense. Mm-hmm. And it's the choice that really matters. And personally, I kind of find that the choice is absent in a lot of discussion about environments and exploring them. And in this sense, you just, brainstorming like this and thinking of ways that the environment can be made more extreme and like a place to adventure in will lead you to those moments where you've got like just more variety. You can mm-hmm. say like, oh, I don't have to do this same old thing that I was doing. Do something different because I've already tried it out. Got it in my back pocket.
If you like the video, give it a thumbs up and subscribe.
WebDM exists thanks to our Patreon patrons, the Web Demons.
If you join the Web Demons, you'll get our weekly podcast, show audio, discounts that'll save you way more than $5 a month on books and dice, and so much more. Check out our free podcast episodes right now, including our free interview with Luke Gygax about all things D&D.
If you like our advice for your games, then why don't you come check us out and watch us play?
Yeah, we've got games on Twitch every week, and they're archived on our second YouTube channel, WebDM Plays.
Thanks for watching.
A lot of my prep process involves watching nature documentaries while I prep. Whoa. Because I want to get in the feel for where the place is and what, you know, what's going on with it. So yeah.
Oh, definitely. In the way that like planet Earth is broken up, right? It's like,
oh, sure, yeah,
oceans,
yeah.
Mountains. It's like, it's right there.
It's right there.
Just
yeah.
Watch that and just add some wings to those sure. ocelots that are climbing up a mountain. Or, like when I see a goat like climbing up a vertical cliff, and I'm just there's not even magic in the world, and how are these fuckers doing that,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah, what's that dire mountain goat that's coming for you is going to gonna get you?
Yeah, the charge of the dwarven mountain goat brigade
right. yeah.
straight down a mountain, you know?